Good morning. Today I am going to explain you about the process scheduling. So here we have already discussed a topic called process states. In that process states, we have seen how the process will travel from one state to the other state. Right. So next, coming to the topic called process scheduling. Here, why do we schedule a process? Okay. So before this, we should know how, like, what are the cases we are going with the process scheduling. Okay. So first thing, when I want to discuss about this process scheduling, for what purpose we are scheduling the process? Okay. So here, how do you want to schedule and what you want to do? Okay. So basically, when we used to have a uniprocess system, at that time, like example of MS-DOS, then at that time, whenever we are allocating a process, to the CPU along with the input output operations. Okay, so here in the uniprocess system, what it is happening is the process is allocated to the CPU. Once the CPU, whenever the process required an input output operation, at that time the process is given for the input output operations. Okay, so here what is happening at that time, the process CPU, that means the processor CPU is very much free. So it is not having any work to execute one more process. So when we go with the multi-process system, so here what is happening, whenever a process is using a CPU, that means the process is trying to execute it work, so at that time the other process can also use an input output operation. This is all based on this process scheduling algorithms. Okay? So basically we have few scheduling algorithms where today we were going to discuss about the first come, first serve scheduling algorithm. So here, whenever we want to discuss about the first come, first serve scheduling algorithm, I would like to tell you that one more point, like here, whenever we were selecting a process, that means whenever the process is being created, so at that time, what here we require is, we should select the process in such a way that the CPU should not be free. Okay, that means CPU should not be idle. So first you have to check how the process, whatever the process you are selecting, so that process CPU utilization should be maximum. That means the selection of process should be in such a way that there should not be, the CPU should not be idle for long time. Okay. So next, coming to the second case, whenever we are going to the other point, why to schedule that? So here we have to discuss about maximum throughput. Maximum throughput. It means that with per unit time, how many processes were trying to execute? Okay, so that is comes under the throughput. Okay, so that should be maximum. And next, coming to the third case, there should be minimum turnaround time. So that should be minimum. What is the turnaround time? It's nothing but how much time the process is taking to finish off its task. Okay. So that is the turnaround. That turnaround time should be minimum. So coming to the fourth case, there should be a minimum waiting time. That means the process should not wait for the long time for its execution. While you are scheduling a process, so that should contain maximum CPU utilization. Thank you. And other one is non-preemptive. So first, what is preemptive? So what is preemptive scheduling? Like what exactly it is? Right. So here we have already studied one point, like whenever a process is being created or being created, so at that time the process should be same. That means the CPU utilization should be maximum. At the same time, the process, whatever the process we are taking, so for that the input output requirement, that means the input output execution, that state also should be same. That means a process may be in use with execution by processor, or the process may be in use with like input output resources. Okay, so here while we are selecting the process, we should concentrate on both the criteria so that the process will be scheduled properly and there will not be any disturbance with the CPU. Right, so here whenever we want to discuss about the preemptive thing, what is a preemptive process? So it's nothing but here, once a process is assigned, suppose assume that there are two or three processes like P1, P2 and P3 process. Right, so this process P1, P2, P3 all are waiting in the ready queue. Process P1, process P2 and process P3, they were ready, that means they were being created and ready for running, so that means they were ready for execution. So once a process is ready, then it is given to the running state. The process P1 is assigned to the running state. Assume that the process P1 has to be executed around 10 milliseconds. So at that time, the process will be executed in the processor for 10 milliseconds. Okay, suppose there is one more process which is ready for execution, which is having most priority. Suppose assume that process P2 is higher priority when compared with process P1. This process P1, which is already in the CPU, that means it is running for execution, so that can be terminated in the middle. That means it's not like terminated, we can stop this process and give an access to the process P2. It's nothing but you can create a process. That means a process can be preempted in the memory. Right. So preemptive is nothing but suppose like whenever a process is already in CPU. So once if other process is having a higher priority, so that higher priority process can be given a first priority. That means given an opportunity for executing by stopping the previous process. That is called preemptive. So next, coming to the non-preemptive section. So here it is opposite to preemptive, where it will not be preempted at all. The process will not be preempted at all. Suppose the same case, if I want to take, this is a running state, that means the process should be like for running state it should come, and this is the ready queue where P1, P2, P3 were there. Right. Assume that this is around 10 milliseconds and this is around 5 milliseconds and this is around 2 milliseconds. Just assume like that. Right. Now, I'll put it as at least 25 milliseconds. Right. So, non-preemptive is nothing but it cannot be, the process cannot be preempted in middle. Once a process is assigned to the CPU for execution, right, even though the process with the highest priority is waiting in the ready queue, the process P1 cannot be preempted in the middle. So which means that it is a non-preemptive. Okay, I hope you understood what is preemptive and non-preemptive. Preemptive is nothing but whenever a process is already in CPU, it is already working, forcefully we can preempt that process and give an access to the other process. If suppose whenever there is a non-preemptive, so here process P1 is assigned for the CPU, and suppose the other process is waiting, even though it is having highest priority, the process P1 cannot be terminated in the middle, which is nothing but a non-preemptive. Okay, so I hope you understood what is preemptive and non-preemptive. Right. So whenever we were discussing about these scheduling algorithms, some scheduling algorithms have an option of preemption, and other scheduling algorithms have an option of both preemption and non-preemption, and the other scheduling algorithms have only an option of non-preemption. So here preemption means forcefully, like it means that forcefully we can preempt a process from the CPU and give an opportunity for the other process. Non-preemption means once the process is assigned to the CPU, until and unless it finishes its task, we can remove that process in the memory. Okay. So coming to the first one, first scheduling algorithm, that is first come, first serve. Okay. So first come, first serve. The name itself says that whichever process comes first, that is served first. Okay. So we all know the meaning of first come, first serve. Right, so here is the chart where you can see the process, how they have arrived in the value queue and what are it burst times. Right, so based on this, we were going to draw a Gantt chart and we will know what is that processes. Okay, so here, the first one is they have given the process ID and then they have given the arrival time and the burst time. So, process ID is like process 1, process 2. You are giving some unique number to that process. Okay. So, arrival time is nothing but here what we are doing is for how much time, that means at what time the process has arrived into the ready queue. Okay. It's not the time which we take like 9:30, 10:30 or 12:30. It's okay. So, it is a normal arrival time which process has arrived first, second, third. The third one is like burst time. Burst time is nothing but how much time the process has to be executed. That is regarding the burst time. So, first, for any of the scheduling algorithms, you should be able to you have to draw a Gantt chart. Okay? So, it's nothing much in this Gantt chart. Just we start from here. So, every time you should think how the Gantt chart will be started. Based on the arrival time, the Gantt chart will start. Okay, assume that there is a ready queue. There is a ready queue. In that ready queue, process P0 has entered first. Process P. That means process P0 has arrived at 0 milliseconds. Okay, its position 0. The CPU scheduling is 0, right? And next process P1, process P2, like that all will be in the ready queue. It means that it is the arrival time, right? So here, whenever a process enters into the ready queue first, that process will be executed in the concept called first come, first serve. Yes or no? Right. So here, based on the burst time, and we are taking the criteria is we were discussing about a non-preemption. We were not forcibly removing the process. Okay, so here I am using a concept called non-preemptive. The main criteria for this FCFS is based on the arrival time. So, as the arrival time is 0, 1, 2, 3, so now it is easy for us to start executing. Okay, so the CPU has been started here, and then process P0 is executing for how many milliseconds? That is for its best burst time is 2 milliseconds. Right, so process P2 has been executed, so process P0 has been executed for 2 milliseconds. Right. Later, within this burst time, how many process has arrived into the ready queue? That is process P1 and P2. Both are arrived. Process P1 and P2. into our algorithm. Right. So now what is the next process for execution? As it is first come, first serve, which means that whichever the process comes into the ready queue first, that will be executed, right? So here process P0 is executed, and then next opportunity is for process P1, where we are trying to execute process P1. For how many milliseconds of time? Already the burst time is given, right? It is for 6 milliseconds. So it is already 2, 6 plus 2, 7, 8. Okay, for this much time the process is being executed, right? And next one is process in within 8 milliseconds of time. How many process has arrived into the ready queue? Already within the 2 milliseconds of time till process P2, all the process has arrived in the ready queue. Within 8 milliseconds of time, the remaining process called process P3 and P4 is already available. Now tell me, what is the next process to be executed? It's none other than process P2. Why? Because it has already arrived and waiting for its execution. Right? So based on the scheduling algorithm, we were checking which process has to be executed next. As it is first come, first serve, the process which have already arrived into the ready queue first, that will be executed. For how many milliseconds of time? It is 4 milliseconds of time. Right. So 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay. So just the Gantt chart will be increased. Okay. The CPU burst time is increasing. Like next process P2 is also done. Other one is what? Process P3, which is arrived at 3 and its burst time is 9. Right. P3 is executing. So this all will not be in the normal space. You have to take some space in this while you are drawing it up. So assume that it is executing for 9 milliseconds of time. Right? 90, 20, 29. So it is 20. And the last process which is already in the ready queue is P4. So it is process P4. For how many milliseconds of time? Again, it is around 12 milliseconds of time. 21, 2 plus 1, 3, 3 plus 1, 20. Sorry. 21, right? 21 plus 12, 31, 32, 33. Okay. So, this is all about the Gantt chart of the process scheduling first come, first serve. So, after completion of this, we should try to know how to calculate the turnaround time and the waiting time. So what is the turnaround time? We always used to think that the turnaround time should be minimum and even waiting time should also be minimum. Right. So before this, by watching this diagram, I will try to write the completion time. Okay. So the first process completion time is 2 milliseconds. The second process P1 completion time is 8, process P2 completion time is 12, process P3 completion time is 21, process P4 completion time is 33. Okay, so from this completion time, we should calculate the turnaround time. Okay, so completion time minus is turnaround time. Okay, so here itself you can draw. Whenever suppose if they were asking you in an exam by giving this table, please try to complete in that way so that it will be looking very good. Okay, so completion time minus arrival time. This completion time is 2 and its arrival time is 0. Right? 2 minus 0 it is 2. And next one is 8 minus 1 for process 1, its completion time is 7. 12 minus 2 waiting time will be calculated by turnaround time minus burst time. Okay, so even you have to check the waiting time should be minimum. So again, just try to calculate this waiting time. That is TAD minus burst time. Turnaround time is 2 and the burst time is 2. So process P0 has not been waited for long time. Why? Because as the process is arrived at time 0, so that is the first process which we executed. So 0 minus 0 it is, where it is? 2 minus 2 it is 0. Okay, and next 7 minus 6, this has been waited for only 1 millisecond of time. Then 10 minus 4, it is 6. 18 minus 9, 9. Okay, 29 minus 12, how much it is? 29. 6, 10, 19, 18, 17. Okay, so this is all about the waiting time. Okay, so this is how the